Welcome, everyone, to our first episode of the Phono Stage Show with myself, the Mischievous One, and my buddy here.
I'm the Brown Bandit, better known as the Bandit. Welcome to our first episode.
Bandit and I, before the lockdown happened, we would get together once in a while and introduce music to each other, new music. Sometimes we'd end up reconnecting with some old songs that we just haven't heard in a long time.
During this time being COVID-19 and then, you know, into 2020, we had planned to get together, we being me and Mischief, had planned to get together.
So we figured, why not film these hangouts and just connect with all of you and show all of you new music, introducing you to new artists, new sounds, new genres, even reconnecting, like I said, with old songs that you probably haven't even heard of in a while, or maybe even some songs from an artist that you didn't even know existed. You only listened to particular songs from that artist, and then all of a sudden, here's a song you've never heard. So that's what we want. We want to bring what we enjoy doing together to all of you for you to enjoy as well.
Then COVID hit, and so that kind of got curtailed. Again, Mischief reached out to me and asked if I'd be interested trying to get something together. We're all in isolation. Yeah, we wanted to share our thoughts on music and the music that we're listening to.
So today is our first episode. We have decided to call it On Repeat. These are basically a couple of Bandit songs and a couple of my songs right now that we're both just really feeling from whatever artist, just single tracks. Go for it, my man.
This week, I got back to some tracks that have been on repeat at different times together. First one being by a band called Harmonium. The album's also self-titled Harmonium. It's considered folk music, but I'm going to say that it's progressive folk, or basically folk rock. The rest of their stuff after this first album was definitely progressive folk, but this one's an acoustic masterpiece in my mind. The song's name, and please excuse my pronunciation, is called Un Musicien Parmi Tant d'Autres, roughly translated as a musician among many or amongst many. Yeah, it came out February 20th, 1974. There's 9 tracks on it. Very popular with the French, but just as popular with the English in Quebec. And of course, that filtered out. I failed to mention that, actually. This is a French band out of Quebec. They ended up being one of the most influential bands in Canada as far as French-speaking people went, and definitely one of the most influential bands ever in Quebec, in their music history anyway. As far as recording went, you know, pretty straightforward stuff. I feel all in the same room together. I don't think they were separated. It felt very off the floor and raw. Really yes. Simple, right? Really simple acoustic arrangements as far as bass and guitar went, but clear and concise, warm sounding.
Now here's my thing. Now I'm not someone who indulges in music in other languages. Not that I have a problem with it or there's anything wrong with it. It's just I like to feel a whole song itself, and because I don't understand French, it was really hard for me to jump into it. After days of listening to this song to check it out, I had to do it. I needed to feel the song the way I feel like it was supposed to be felt. Listening to it one day, I decided to pull up the lyrics, you know, translate it to English, and sure enough, as soon as I did that, as soon as I learned what the song was about, fell in love with the song. The lyrics of the song, if I remember correctly, when I looked them up, were along the lines of a musician who plays in a cafe all the time. Eventually, over time, his name gets erased off the board and someone else's name is there. And the words that they wrote in the song, someone is better. This new person is better. And then that brought the musician down emotionally. But then he realized over time that it wasn't that the person was better. The person was just... It was just a newer, different sound. This is obviously related to musicians everywhere that go and play at bars or
whether big or small.
Yeah, whether big or small, you play in the same place all the time. At some point, you're just the regular there, right? You're the guy that just is there all playing all the time, right? When someone new with a new sound, even if they're playing the same type of music, comes in, everyone's going to draw to them than you. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just, man, you know, you can go like 20 minutes away from this place and probably do the exact same thing that person just did. Ain't a whole new sound for a whole new group of people, right? And I think that's where I really, really fell in love with the song. Yeah, the writing of the storytelling of the song, the lyrics are very good.
What I got out of it and of course read about and listened to, I feel touches everybody. Not just what he was initially speaking of, which was musicians themselves. I feel he was speaking of life's variances, the what's happening, the ups and downs, the ins and outs, the, you know, the money coming and going, all that kind of stuff happening, and the feeling of that, and of being a musician and going through that, not only in life, but in his career or her career, right?
This is really cool to hear a song like this, because I've never heard a song about, you know, it's like you said, the ups and downs, right? And this is basically the ups and downs of a musician's career. Feel from the music, the feel from the guitars. I thought it was going to become more harder, or not harder, just more alternative-y, and just come in a little heavier. And no, the whole song stuck through to the whole feel. Even actually slowed down at one part, which kind of calms down, but then comes back in, and then they bring in a choir.
Yeah, it builds back up again, right?
It fills it in. It fills it in very nicely.
It's one of those tracks that you can play softly, and you can hear the subtleties and the details and that kind of stuff, or you can crank and get into it, and it's going to hit you a different way.
It's 7 minutes of it's 7 minutes of a little tiny bit of an up and down hill when it comes to instrumentation. You enjoy the ride the whole way through. And the arrangement is very simple. The song is very simple. I like the song for something that I wouldn't have looked at because of the fact that it's just another language. Yeah.
So again, what I liked about it, raw, is acoustic, sounds off the floor, and again, it speaks to just about anybody. What do you got off for your first one, Mischief?
Okay. So, for my first one, my first choice that I wanted to introduce to all of you, a man named Riley. The song is called Marijuana. Riley is a French-Algerian rap hip-hop artist. He does not actually rap in it, but he sings in it, and it's soulful, and it's organic, and the message is simple, the music is simple, and it's one of those songs that you just like, you just feel it, the way he uses his vocals with the beat and the music piece in it. It's so fitted and fits and so perfect. It's a perfect song to just close your eyes, rock with, and just snap your fingers, man, right? And the song is Marijuana, right? You just light one up and then that's it. Unfortunately, as great as the song is, and just to fit in with the title of this episode, this song is on repeat all the time for me because it's only 2 minutes and 40 seconds. It sucks that it's so short, but I feel like I gotta listen to it at least 3 or 4 times until I'm satisfied, right? Until I'm satisfied to go on to the next song.
I can't agree with you more in the sense of it's too short. It left me wanting more. It's one of those tracks that's like just a couple of minutes, and I give me a minute or two more. Just a minute or two more. It's such a, at the risk of sounding cheesy, it's such a pretty little ditty.
Now, the album that the song is on, it's called Welcome to the Jungle. It's a 13-song track as of right now, but it's been like slowly progressing over the years, where he's been adding a couple songs to it over time. This is actually really smart because of the fact that albums are still important. That's a fact, right? Artists still need to come up with albums. But what's important more than anything else right now in the world we live in when it comes to music is the single. Just the one song. You need that. You need those hits to come out. And I think that's kind of like where this album is going, is every year he kind of releases a couple songs and those songs just go on that album. In the song now, there's a talking point with a modulated lower voice. doing my research, I found out that that voice is actually Snoop Dogg. So he Snoop Dogg's in the song and does a little bit of talking about marijuana, which, now the song itself is about marijuana, but not necessarily the herb itself. What it's actually about is the effects and relationship between an individual and the green. He refers to marijuana as a woman. And he says how, like, baby, you know, you're on my mind all the time, but you're wasting my time, right? If I do you, I'm going to just mellow out and not want to do anything and just kind of chill and just relax and vibe out. You know, sometimes you got shit to do. But in the song as well, he still talks about the fact that he caves. And he's just like, I gave in. I had to do it. I love the way it feels. It mellows me out. It chills me out. You know, I'm just going to relax now kind of thing. And it's, you know, it's what we love about it, right? We love the feeling it gives us, and that's what it is.
It's laid back. To me, this is going to show my age, and I don't care. To me, it was very throwback sounding. It made me feel very nostalgic towards that late 90s, like mid-90s to mid-2000s R&B.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It really,
and for
really...
it to come out last year and yeah. Hold true to yeah. that feel.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I'll say... Thumbs up on a good single.
It's an amazing song. It's just
too damn short.
Artists, stop making so many damn good short songs.
Yeah, that's but maybe that's his hook. That's his hook. Done well caught you, man.
That's true. That's very true.
Give me one second here. I'm gonna pull something up here. Let's get comfy here. All right. Mischief. Next up, I'm going to talk about an album we all know about. If it is that you are listening to current music, it's popular now, but, you know, started off underground. It's the new, so it's out of the, he is out of the new SoCal scene, Southern California. You know, we saw it in the 70s, and I'm a big fan of all that stuff and certain groups that were bundled into that SoCal sound. We see a new version of this, and it's Anderson .Paak's. Is his name, and
Love Anderson .Paak.
Yeah.
Love Anderson .Paak.
Malibu is the album name. It came out on January 15th, 2016. It is his second studio album. A lot of people don't know that because it's the first time that a lot of us had heard of Anderson .Paak in the general public, let's say. I heard that album. It was my album of the year. I've gotten the Compton's Most Wanted soundtrack bought for me as a gift. I kept on hearing this guy, and I kept on thinking, man, that really sounds like Kendrick singing. This guy sounds like, whoever this is, sounds like Kendrick singing. I didn't know he was drumming on it. He's on like 5-6 tracks on that album. Like, he's a session drummer, right? Was. Is. Could still be. And again, this album was gifted to me. It was sold out everywhere. You could not find this on Wax. I managed to get a first press somehow. My homegirl Madeline saw it walking down the street. At 2 in the morning and picked it up for me the next day. Called as soon as it was open. She's like, I got a surprise for you. She's like, I got to rush. She left work early and went and got this album for me, man. I'm so thankful for it. Again, it was my album of the year. The song I'm going to talk about is The Season / Carry Me. It's a two-part song made 6 or 7 years or at least several years apart by two different producers that he lumped together. And this thing is just beautiful. It covers that SoCal feel. I think it's timeless. It covers different genres within the song, which is really cool. It's an album for all generations, front to back. We rarely hear front. You had touched on singles and how that is. That's the bottom line these days. This is a full album. You put it on, you leave it on. You don't got to worry about it. Hang on for the flipping ride. And yeah, I miss those too because they're rare and far between.
Right? It's really rare to be able to actually listen nowadays. Actually listen to a new album from beginning to end and, you know, just love it.
Here's the thing. There's very few albums in my repertoire that I can say this about. I've listened to this album front to back more than 1,000 times. It's just one of those albums that got me. And this was definitely that. I'm glad we agree on that wholeheartedly, Mischief. It's laid back. It starts off laid back and soulful, right? And then it switches and it goes into this wicked hip-hop fusion-y kind of stuff.
He has a lot of old-school feel.
Absolutely. Right? There's that soul to him. My mind's got soul.
It's actually just amazing. This song particularly, it from beginning to end, the instrumentation starts off a little, is just a little, almost a little eerie sounding. But then Anderson .Paak comes in, the beat comes in, and he sings.
There's a lot of reverb on it. And the vocals, I was reading up about this actually, the vocals really, really saturated, lots of echo, and like lots of vocal harmonies going on. We hear the D'Angelo influence there. We could touch on that a different time though, man.
Yeah, D'Angelo is a whole nother monster of a person to talk about.
And if you're looking for similar artists, maybe not necessarily from Southern California, but that feeling, they're lumped into a group together, they're posse'd up, right? K-Tronada, Kendrick Lamar, you know, Thundercat, NX Worries, and of course, my man Mac Miller was lumped into that group too, and we can do a whole episode about Mac at some point too. If you want to talk genres, you know, R&B, hip-hop, neo-soul, he touches on all of that kind of stuff, funk, soul, all kinds of stuff, right? Jazz. There's a genre, let's go broad-based with this statement, called acid jazz. Now, Stevie Wonder gets lumped into there, and or rare grooves. In my opinion, Stevie Wonder is like a father of early acid jazz kind of stuff, right? Then we fast forward to the 90s, and I used to go to acid house jams and acid house parties and acid jazz parties and all this kind of stuff back then. And there was this dude named Jamiroquai. And to me, he was updated Stevie Wonder. Now we got this cat, Anderson .Paak, and we've updated again. And this sound coming out of SoCal and Anderson .Paak, they're bringing it. Again, the song switches just past the halfway point, right? And it kind of references his early struggles. It's that same thing. We want out of where we are, and we want to go to the big city, and we want to leave wherever we're at to get to somewhere else, like the grass is greener kind of thing, right? So that's what it kind of references. So that was my second track. What do you got for me, Mischief?
All right, my second choice is by an artist that my sister actually introduced me to. His style is soul, R&B, kind of jazz fusion. His writing style is phenomenal. He's very motivated, and he's very into himself and his music, and you can hear it in everything that he makes. So this particular song that I'm talking about today is called Queen Tings off the Lady Lady album, which is a 14-track album. This song is just over 3 minutes long. And the song is sung by Masigo, featuring with Tiffany. Not a whole lot of songs that I've come across of his that I just haven't fallen in love with something in it. And I'm a huge fan. I don't want to say I'm a huge fan, but I do love my jazz. I love my jazz. I love my saxophone, and he adds a lot of saxophone to a lot of his songs, and I just love the feel of it and love hearing it. He does rapping, he does singing. This song particularly is actually celebrating and praising Black beauty. So it's celebrating the creation of Black women. He actually, the lyrics of the song, what he does is he talks about and gives shout out to different actresses and different musical artists in the world today, right? Like it, and it's all in his lyrics. He talks about Rashida Jones. He talks about Sharon Leal. He talks about Regina Hall, Lisa Bonet. Like he just conveys the power of Black women and the independence of Black women and the beauty of what a Black woman looks like. And he throws it all into a song. This like reggae dance hall, jazz, soul concoction of awesome, like
whether known or unknown, we have this crop of newer, we would have called them R&B or soul artists, but you know, getting lumped into that, I'm using that lumped word a lot today, they're getting put into that neo soul category. I'm gonna put them into this. For me, that's, I don't just lump anybody into there. This guy's got it, man. From the minute you first played him for me, you know, what was that, 2 years ago now? This song hit me with that fusion. You know I listen to a lot of jazz. This song just, again, both your tracks were that, just that groovy kind of thing. But on the other hand, you crank this, and you're jamming out to this. Your air saxophone. I caught myself doing that over here on the left side of my living room, jamming it out.
And they're like, man, I gotta be real. You could throw this on in the bedroom, man. You could 100% throw this on in the bedroom.
And not just the song, the album. It's a sexy album, man.
Oh, the Lady Lady album, 100%. Yes, 100% from beginning to end is a very, very sexy album. His production is crisp, it's clean. The people that make it for a reason. And he has that reason. Right? His music has that reason, right? Everything he does.
We hear artists that we've never heard before at times, and we think, oh, he sounds like this, or she sounds like this, or they sound like this band, or they sound like this, or don't you think he kind of sounds like this, but he also sounds like this, or she has the vibrato of this person, but then, you know what that is? Nostalgia. And that generally means that they're good. They're hitting parts on your brain pan that are hitting you off well. He's got elements of this person or that person, but his own voice manages to get through. That's where I'll give it up for this young cat.
Masigo is another person to check out for sure. Again, the song is Queen Tinks. Okay, what's your last choice, sir?
All right, my last pick on repeat is a Boogie Down Productions track.
I think very deeply. Fuck, I love that shit.
Look, and I got to just smile as soon as I said that. Right away. It's
your poker face is terrible.
Yeah, I couldn't even keep poker face on that, man. You would have just had my fucking loot, man. Excuse my language.
Well, it's Boogie Down.
Yeah, it's Boogie Down. I know, man. One of my all-time GOAT hip-hop groups. Also, KRS-One, known as the teacher of rap. By himself and then by the rest of our damn selves.
If you are a fan of hip-hop, you know who Boogie Down Production is. You know who they are.
Yeah, Scott LaRock and DJ Red Alert and the gang, you know, the whole gang, you know. The song I'm going to be talking about today, which I will get to, is off an album called By All Means Necessary. It came out May 31st, 1988. It's got 10 tracks on it. It went gold, certified gold in 89, which was rare for a hip-hop album back then. I mean, that was... Let me rephrase that. We're right in the golden age of hip-hop right there. I like to say there's two golden ages. There's 80s to late 80s, and then we got just after the early 90s to just after the mid 90s. Those are my two golden ages of hip-hop, period. So yeah, this comes at the end of the first one. It does, it's just about to usher into some uncharted territory for a bit and then to a new golden age, right? The album cover art, right away, you know what you're getting into. It's a reference to Malcolm X, you know, By All Means Necessary. And he's standing there with, I think it's an Uzi.
Yeah, it's an Uzi.
Yeah, I believe it.
He's just like...
He's standing there on the corner, the window, just like, peeping out, you know? Like, it's black man. And white, it's gritty looking. Man.
Shit's about to go off.
Yeah, it was right? Praised. No,
it's praised. It's a powerful time.
Absolutely, you know, in New York, definitely, and across the United States, a little bit in Canada. We didn't feel the racial tension as much as down south of us. This is considered a landmark of political hip hop, and was praised for its social commentary at the time. Right, it really spoke to what was going on around them. It is also on the all-time 100 best hip-hop albums by Source Magazine, still rated. The song I'm going to talk about is called My Philosophy. It is an aggressive, in-your-face track. The sample on it, again, back to that jazzy feel. I'll always try to touch back onto it. Gentleman named Stanley Turrentine. He was on a label called CTI by, you know, Cree Taylor was this awesome producer, and he had all these great jazz artists of the time. My favorite time being mid to late 70s on that label. Stanley Turrentine is the gentleman playing, and it's a sample of Sister Sanctified. That's that saxophone. Oh, man. So it's minimal. That beat is minimal and raw. It's just raw production, hard-hitting beats in your face. Just simple. You know, basic beats. He gives an angry speech against what was going on in hip hop at the time. It was his call to arms. Like, yeah, that's what you got. Well, this is what I got. How about that? This is my philosophy. It was against common misconceptions of black people. It was against the record companies putting out this crop of crap for the almighty dollar, for the almighty bottom end. Right, so this was his call to arms against that and against how black people were looked at in the community. So a very powerful, mind-altering, game-changing, album-changing one for me. I thought, you know, I was, what, 89 or 15? I am an angry, angsty youth looking for some answers, right? So my philosophy was one of them, right? So yeah, that's my third track, man.
That's awesome. No, Boogie Down is an awesome, awesome last track. I think very deeply.
What about you? What you got for me?
My last choice for everyone is a big one for me. It's a big one for the world. They just need to find them. That's it. And here we are, introducing them to all these artists. Now, my choice, I've come across this band randomly. I have heard this band, this particular song as well. I have heard this group's songs in TV shows, on radio. Anyone I run into has either heard the song and doesn't know the artist, or knows the artist but only knows this one song from the artist. This song is called Colors, and the artist is Black Pumas. It's a duo band from Austin, Texas. These guys make a psychedelic soulfulness to their music. They made this amazing song, 4 minutes long, off of a self-named album that came out last year. The album has 10 songs on it. They are conjuring up this late 60s, early 70s sound. And for a band playing music now, to hold true to that is out of this world. It's awesome to hear someone make this type of music. Because it's like a Motown era with a modern update to it.
I can't agree more. Right from the minute I saw the album art.
Yes, the album cover is very simple.
What did you think? As soon as I saw the album cover art, two things came.
Black Panthers
and Blaxploitation. And Kung Fu Flicks.
And all Kung Fu Flicks.
Oh no, seriously. All wrapped into one neat package on that album cover. Beautiful. That's what led me to it. Black Pumas, whatever. Look at them. I'm like, what is this, man? So that was that. I think that was our first clue as to what to expect on the album in retrospect now.
So the song is actually it's basically themes of morality and togetherness, that they went out in early mornings and seen all the colors in the sky from the sun. Inspiration came in, and this song of, like I said, morality and togetherness of people and us in this crucial time.
Absolutely. It does definitely draw people together.
Like, this is the perfect song for this.
Touching on what you said there for a second, I loved the throwback feel of this, man.
It has a classic soul, funk, and like East Coast kind of hip-hop.
Blue-eyed soul meets, you know, soul. Let me take that back. Just soul. It just got that old-school soul. Beautiful feeling, man.
The way they do their drums is very like I said, an East Coast hip hop kind of feel to it. The raspiness of his voice with the instrumentation, it's so perfect, so perfectly well blended together. Because there's a lot of different elements. The hook catches you, even like the plucky blues guitar that I was saying in the beginning. The guitar's chord progression catches you right away. When the beat comes in, it catches you right away. The gospel, the gospel-like organ that's in there as well in the background.
Yeah, or you got that northern soul. You got that northern soul in there. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's just layer of dynamic and emotional intensity, dude. Like, it's the kind of song you feel in your gut. You listen to it and it just hits you there, and you're like, this song is amazing, man. This song is amazing. This band is amazing. That's my last choice. Black Pumas, The Colors. On repeat.
Hey, people out there. Thank you for joining us on our inaugural episode of Phono Stage. I'm Bandit.
Mischievous One. We'll be coming out with another episode hopefully soon, with a whole nother list of songs for you guys to check out and a whole nother list of artists for you to check out.
Yeah, we'll get back at you.
Take care and be safe.
Be safe with your families.
Enjoy.
Take care.
Peace.